And the year was 2005. I was living in Moravian Falls. And one night, close to midnight, I had a heavenly visitor visit my room and came through the door and sat down on my bed. And I'm assuming it was an angel. I couldn't see the person, but I could see the bed go down, and I could feel the presence in the room, and there was this indentation in the mattress as he sat there. And then, after 2 minutes, got up and just walked out the door, never said a word to me. So I was actually coming down here to do a conference at that time, and about a month later, I came down here, and Bob Jones was sitting there. And so I told him about it. You know Bob, he knows everything. And I said, so Bob, what do you think that was? He goes, don't you know, boy? You know, when Bob says, don't you know, boy, he knows that you don't know what he knows. But you want to say, sure, I know. And he goes, don't you know what that was? And I go, no, I don't. He goes, that there was a watcher angel. And I said, a what? He said, that there was a watcher angel. And I asked the question I shouldn't have asked. I said, so what was he doing? And Bob said, watching you. And then he said, if he comes back, just say to him what Samuel said to the Lord, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. And say to the angel, what do you want to tell him? Because he's waiting for a response from you. And that's good Bob advice, Bobology. I live by that. So I go home, and I spend a couple of months waiting, and I don't know, months pass. And again around midnight, the same thing happened, except this time I'm pretty sure it was Gabriel. And he was in the room, and immediately I was caught up into I said, what do you want to say to me? And immediately I was caught into the spirit realm. I was in the bedroom, but I was in the spirit realm, was in the heavenlies, and I was over this nation. I was in four or five places in this dimension that I'd never been before, and had this incredible experience. And I won't tell you all of it, just a little piece of it. In this experience, this angel handed me a book, and it was a book of seeing. And it was a book of antiquity beaten out of old brass and had green edges. And he said to me, this book has belonged to many men throughout history, but I'm giving this book to you, I'm handing this book to you. And a long story short, after some discussion, the book turned into a television screen, and I could see the future. And so this was 2005, and beginning in 2006 to 2012, I saw hundreds of headlines in the newspaper. And as the calendar page turned on this book, as I go through this book, I was seeing, you know, headlines. And I saw all the way to the end of 2012. And at the end of 2012, the vision ended. And as I had this book in my hand, I dropped this book inadvertently on the ground, and didn't mean to. It slipped out of my hands. And it rolled down this long hill. It was a very dark hill. And it disappeared into the darkness at the bottom of the hill. And I thought, what a precious gift to be given to me and for me to drop. And I'm a steward over this, so I need to chase it. And I ran down the bottom of the hill in this vision experience encounter I was having. And when I reached the bottom of the hill, I felt around for the book, and I felt the book, and I grabbed it, and I put it to my chest. And at the same time I did that, the voice from the top of the hill that I couldn't see anymore because it was so dark there said, just as you chase this book down a long, dark hill, so shall the economy in this nation go down a long, dark hill. And I came out of the vision. And I was pondering some of those things and about the vision, some things I received, and how that I'd received things, headlines, things I couldn't remember that only began to come up in my spirit later. Hundreds of headlines, and for a 2-year period, headlines of newspapers every day were going at a millisecond by my face, and I was able to catch one out of every 300 or 400 of them. And I saw a couple things, and I saw some things that were very interesting about 2006 and 7. And by 2008, I saw the headlines about 2008, and in the spring of 2008, I began to talk about September, the crash that a lot of prophetic people had seen as well, that the Lord had showed me in this vision, the economic crash that was coming, began to prophesy that in churches and et cetera. And then I saw some headlines about Hollywood actors dying, and Sid Roth got me on national TV and pinned me down on that one, and I began to talk about that. The next week is when the first one did, and there was a series of that. And so just a series of different things. Then I saw the oil Gulf explosion that was in the Gulf and forgot about it until 3 months before the Haiti incident, and was so distraught by it because I knew that the Lord said there was going to be hell in the Gulf, there was going to be explosion, it was going to wreck the you know, much of the Gulf and the industry and the ecology and things. So I was really distraught about that, didn't know what to do. I actually called Washington, D.C., have a friend who's in Homeland Security there, and called Washington, D.C. about them, what to do about, told them about what I know the Lord has shown me years ago in the vision about the Gulf exploding. And there was dead silence on the other end of the line, of course, so I didn't know what to do. So I finally thought, well, I'll just call somebody. So I called Benny Johnson, which is Bill Johnson's wife, who's an intercessor, and told her about it, and she said, I'll put 1,000 intercessors on it right now. And so for then the Haiti earthquake happened, and they thought, well, that was what Larry saw, and emailed me. I said, no, that's not what the headline said. It said that the Gulf of Mexico was going to explode, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they went back to prayer, and of course that happened, and that was the end of it. Well, at the end of that, I remembered that at the end of some of these visions I had seen and headlines that I'd seen, that there was a period of about a year and a half where I saw nothing happen. And it was at part of the last part of 2010 and all the way through 2011 and part of 2012. And then in 2012, it all picked up again, these occurrences and these good and bad things and bittersweet things that were coming upon the earth. So I said all that to say this. I was meditating on this. And this summer, and thinking, you know, nothing catastrophic has really happened, and things seem to be running pretty smoothly, and we seem to be pulling out of some of the economic downdrafts that we have been in, and things seem to be rolling well. And the Lord began to talk to me about the eye of the storm. And he began to talk to me about how that right now we're in the eye of the storm, and told me about the reasons that we're in this holding pattern. And he began to talk about how that we're about to come out of the eye of the storm and hit the back wall of that storm. Now, immediately you think negative, but really when you're talking about being in the eye of the storm and the back wall coming, depending on the circumstances and the current weather patterns and a lot of different factors will determine whether there's more rain or less rain, whether it's worse or better. And so it's yet to be determined in the eye of the storm what the rest of the storm is going to look like. So I was thinking about that. I was thinking about the eye of the storm and how that the quiet feeling that we had and some of this sense of perhaps false security that we have in this nation truly was us being in the middle of the eye of the storm, and the back wall of that storm was looming and is threatening us in a very real way. And so while I'm thinking about that, this is August of this year, September of this year, I'm dreaming. And I'm dreaming that I'm preaching just like I'm preaching to you, and I'm doing what I call maintenance ministry and just restating some of the obvious and expressing to you things that you already know and that I already know that we're not going to do, but we say again, hoping we'll do them eventually. And so I'm talking about them and reminding us of you and me, you know, just preaching and doing what I do. And right in the middle of the sermon, I begin to scream. And I begin to scream, it's going to rain. And I began to scream at the top of my voice with alarm. It's going to rain, it's going to rain. And I didn't know if it was good or bad. I just knew that rain like we had never seen was coming. And as I began to scream that in this dream, the rain began to pound on the roof of the church that I was in so heavy, you couldn't hear my voice. My voice was muted. And as loud as I screamed into the microphone, nobody could hear me. And people were excited, and they were jumping out of their chairs, and they were running out of the building. And this rain was so heavy and so loud that it was near frightening. So I woke up from that dream, and when I woke up, I was literally screaming at the top of my voice, it's going to rain, it's going to rain, it's going to rain, it's going to rain. So a week or so went by, and I forgot the dream. And by the second week, I was sitting in my office. And sitting in my office at home, looking at my email, I was caught up in the spirit again, and it began to rain on me in my bedroom. And a rain like I had never felt or seen before. It was so real to me that I had to put my hands over my head to protect myself from the rain, the pounding rain that was falling on me. And it was so real that I ran out of my bedroom, down into our family room, the big family room, and I got on the carpet on the floor in a fetal position and put my hands over my head because the sound was deafening and the rain was pelting me so hard. But what was interesting about the rain was one minute it was a driving rain like you would have before a great flood or a great storm, and then the next minute the raindrops turned into stacks of $100 bills and blessings and promises, and it would go back and forth from threat to promise, from threat to promise, from threat. So it seemed to be a mixture of the best and the worst of the worst. It seemed to be a bittersweet rain that was pounding me. That lasted for about 20 or 30 minutes, and for 2 or 3 days, I could smell rain, I could feel rain, I knew, and that we are in the eye of the storm, and we're fast approaching the back wall of that storm. And I knew that back wall of that storm was close upon us. So I go to a church close to the city there, and I'm telling this vision, this dream that I have to them, in a day session, in the middle of the day. And as soon as I stopped telling this to them, within 3 seconds, out of nowhere, this rain came. And for 10 minutes, you couldn't hear yourself think in this building because the rain that was pounding on this building. And I thought, I think God's trying to tell me something. So I went home and began to think about, Lord, I know that. And I understand that it's time to posture. Right now, it's all about posture. How we survive or how we face 2012 and beyond will be determined by the posture of 2010 and 2011. And I believe that we're in the eye of the storm because God has given us a place of redemption because he's unfailingly redemptive. And he's given us a space of repentance. He's given us a place to prepare and posture ourselves for the coming rains. He gave Noah that option. And depending on your posture in Noah's flood would depend on whether it would be devastating or a blessing to you. It was all about posture. So 2012 and beyond is about posture. 2011 is about how we posture ourselves. And how we posture ourselves, what we do, how we face where we're at and who we are, and how we listen to God, and how we humble ourselves, and how we direct our spirit will determine the rest of our lives. Because I believe that God's people in the church have the privilege of writing history. Moses argued with God and changed what would be probable history. And I believe that God has given us a rare opportunity as a generation, as a church, as a nation, to rewrite history. And I believe that it's not yet been determined, and the court session in heaven is still out because the jury is still out upon the specifics of what's going to happen 2012 and beyond. And because I believe God has given all power unto the believer, the spiritual believer, and Jesus has transferred the will of rights and the bill of rights, if you want to call that, to the believer. And he said, and Calvary, it is finished. Now behold, I give you all power and all authority. So I believe the kingdom of God is motion activated. And what I mean by that is we have to do something to set in motion the will of God. So I believe the next year to the year and a half is about you and I setting in motion the will of God in this time that God has set aside for us. And why not? If God would give Jezebel a space of repentance and a time to posture herself for humility, why would God not give this nation and give us a place of repentance and a place to posture ourselves to face what is coming? So whether it be good or whether it be bad, whether it be the worst of times or the best of times, it doesn't matter to us because our spirit is postured right. Joseph faced catastrophic financial disaster in corporate Egypt when famine in the land, but it didn't matter to him because he was postured properly because David said the word of the Lord tried Joseph and found him faithful. So when he stepped away from that prison into the throne room of Egypt, he faced economic collapse. He faced some of the same things that we're facing in this nation: immorality, economic collapse, great and powerful famine, and all that happened in his time is a potential for our time, a probability for our time. But nevertheless, he succeeded. Not only did he succeed, but he went beyond everybody's wildest expectation because he was postured in hope and he was postured in spirit, and he had a word and a promise from God that he would not only survive survive, but that he would be blessed with blessing pressed down, shaken together, and running over.